Everyone, as Dwayne mentioned, this coming Wednesday really is the first Alpha experience, so it's not too late to invite somebody. It is a great way to introduce somebody to Jesus, so make an invitation. You could change a life forever. Please be praying for Alpha as we enter into it, and just can't wait to see what God is going to do again. Debbie Johnson is back, and some of us may not know who Debbie is because you may not have been around over the fall. This may be your first Sunday, so just to let us all in on the same page, if you will, Debbie has been a minister here at North Bramley since 2008. We've had a history that goes back even longer than that, and grateful for that. Debbie is back now as a VAM, volunteer associate minister, and so you'll see Debbie around a couple Sundays a month in a variety of other forms. We're just so grateful to have Debbie back, aren't we?
It's good to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
We are moving into a series. We were talking about new purpose in January. What a great way to start the year. And really, that takes us a continuation into this series in February called Show Love. Because what greater purpose is there than to show love? That's what Jesus did. It's who he was, and it's who we can be as his followers. So we're going to be talking about show love over this month. We're excited about what God is going to do. Next Sunday, Ted Brown will be here from Regeneration. How do we show love to the poor and the marginalized in our city? The next Sunday, we're talking about love justice, a big topic. Jesus loved justice, and because of that, those are some tough conversations sometimes, but we want to as well. And then the last Sunday, we're going to talk about loving our city. We're going to highlight the Journey Neighborhood Center. It's going to be an incredible Sunday. Hope you can join us throughout this month. Show love.
Great. So what does it mean to show love? I guess I should first say thank you, like that. It is really great to be here. But when we're talking about showing love, I mean, what does love mean? I mean, it's a word that we use so often. We almost bandy it about, oh, love this, love that, love, yeah. And it can lose some of its depth and meaning. I think that love is actually really hard for us to accept and to give fully. I'm part of a small group with Mark Willards leading it, the Holy Fools, which is a great name for our group. And we've been diving into some of the writings of Richard Rohr, who's a Franciscan priest, and he's the founder of the Center for Action and Contemplation in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And he writes a daily blog, and in it, if you subscribe to it, you know that he's talking about the depth of God's love for us, that love is the force, the foundation, the energy of the universe. And it's the kind of force and power love is that can unite and reconcile and take us to places, transform our lives, as we talked about last week, transform us in ways that we don't even ever imagine as being possible. This week, the sort of mind-blowing insight that Mark offered to all of us is that God's love isn't based at all on who we are or what we've done. And I hope that most of us, if not all of us, know that. I think sometimes we can know it, but maybe we don't always feel it. But so trying to make that journey. But this was the line that just really, really struck me. It says, God's love for us is simply based on this, that you are. So not who you are, not what you've done, just that you are. God loves you because you're you. And that may sound simplistic, but I asked my husband Wayne this week. I said, you know, and for those of you may know, but Wayne rarely comes to church. and yet, you know, since seminary's had a deep faith in theological readings and experiences of God. And so I said to him, do you think that God loves you? And he's like, oh yeah. And I said, why? He said, well, Murray. It was an open-ended question. And he said, because that's God's job. And I thought that was a brilliant answer. So as we're talking about new life, new purpose, you see this quote up on the screen, and this comes from James Finley. It was in Richard Rohr's blog last week, and it says, in the freedom with which we freely choose to give ourselves in love, to the love that gives ourselves to us, so to God, in that reciprocity of love, can't talk anymore, your destiny is fulfilled. You're who you are, your purpose. It's just giving and receiving love. And that means that God's will, God's desire for you is consummated. It's not all these big, huge things that sometimes we think. I'm not saying that that isn't a part of who we are, but our purpose is to receive love, to know we're love, and to show love. It's an amazing circle.
Yeah. This passage from First John chapter 4 is all about that. That it all starts with God, with God's love, to receive that, and then we become a flow through. That out of that abundance of receiving God's love, we can then love others, love the world, love in a new way. So here it is, 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 13. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. We get a glimpse of God when we're loved and when we love others. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. This is core to the Christian faith. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. It all starts with God. And sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Gave himself fully in love, freely and fully. We'll talk about that as we go along here. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, we see God. God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. We do not do this on our own. Show love. So really simply, today's message is about two things. It's about receiving God's love. So part two, we can share God's love. We can show God's love. We can let it flow through us. And I think, as Debbie was saying about her husband Wayne, intellectually, most people would probably get that right on a multiple choice question, that God loves us. But we want to drill down today, how do we receive that? How do we be filled with God's love? How can we enable that to happen and be open to that? And I kind of think of it like a car doesn't run unless it's filled up with some gas. Have you noticed that? I have, because I've run out of gas a few times, literally in the car, but also in life. And I know when we've been teaching our kids, we're at that stage of life where we're teaching our kids to drive, where they sometimes have the vehicles, if you will. And one of the things that we've tried to teach them is that how to go fill up with gas. We're still teaching them how to pay for it, but that'll come over time, I'm sure. But I mean, really, because, and I think that's for us. So the question for us, I think, around this one would be, it's a really good question. There it is. How do we grow our hearts with God's love? Because it's one thing to talk about it. It's one thing to intellectually understand it. But how do we experience that? How can we more and more fill ourselves with God, with God's love, with the Holy Spirit, so that we really can be these flow-throughs, God's people, bringing healing and redeeming and hope and new life to this world?
Yeah. So how do we grow our hearts with God's love? I'm not being flippant when I say I think the first step is to spend some time with God. I mean, that's why we talk in terms of the bullseye, in terms of spiritual practices. We talk about spending time with God every day. Maybe you're doing the Bible in 1 year. Maybe you're participating in the 24/7 prayer. If you're wondering how to be a part of that, I just encourage you to hook into Facebook Live tomorrow and see some of the other ways that you can be a part of growing in God as well. I've found that for myself, to really open myself to God's love and desire for me, I need to be quiet. I need to have just some really quiet, dedicated time. And I find that as I start to breathe in, settle myself down, whether it's for centering prayer or just when I'm feeling anxious about something, and just to take some deep breaths and just breathe in, and I find that there's a space created in me at that point, that there's room for more of God and less of me. You probably all have your own ways. Some of the ones that I have found really helpful is to take a piece of scripture. And just as you're breathing in, just to say the first part of that scripture, and as you're breathing out, to offer the next part. So maybe it's, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So the Lord is my shepherd, and you breathe in, and just say that in your mind, or just speak it out loud. And then, I shall not want, as you breathe out. And just repeating that over and over. Others, one of my favorites is, be still and know that I am God. And it's a line from Psalm 46. It's in verse 10. And a long time ago, a good friend and mentor taught me to do a prayer with that. And so just start off with, be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know. Be still. Be. And I find when I do that, no matter how many butterflies are going, no matter how much tension is there in my back, whatever it is, that will come and settle me down. And I think it's just about shifting our focus. How do we grow in God's love? We shift our focus to God, to God who wants to be in relationship with us. Do you remember when you were courting for the very first time? You know, you met a person that you just wanted to spend time with. Well, what did you do? You spent time with. You kept thinking about them. When you weren't with that person, you thought about them. Sometimes as relationships grow and continue over years, you can get complacent in them. And now you have to make play dates and you have to do all of that kind of thing. But the idea is to spend some time in the company of a person that you love or want to love more. And the best way to do that with God is just spend some time, whether in scripture, just in breathing in, and just finding that space where you can hear God moving in you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dallas Willard used to say that grace is opposed to earning, meaning we don't need to earn God's favor, love, and grace, but it's not opposed to effort, yeah. Meaning that with intentionality, we can create space to have more of God being received into our life. Some people know I was able to be in London, England a couple weeks ago at a church conference at Holy Trinity Brompton, HTB for short. That's where Alpha started. We saw that video on Alpha earlier. It's an amazing church. Very much like here, when people walk in for the first time, they'll often say, there was something, there was an energy, a life. We would call that the Holy Spirit. It's there in incredible ways in this church. And it was just so powerful to be there. And it was also amazing to spend so much time in worship. In the 5 days we were there, I don't think I've ever worshiped so much in my life. And I felt like my heart grew in that time. I felt like my love for Jesus, his love for me, my desire to share it, like it just, my heart actually grew in that time through worship. We're looking forward to expanding our worship, to worshiping more because of that, because our hearts grow as we focus on God and less on ourselves. It's amazing. There's actually a scientific basis to this, if someone is still not convinced. There's evidence for this. I'm reading a book right now by a guy named Dr. Andrew Newberg, and the title of the book is How God Changes Your Brain. The way I got onto this book was from Director X, otherwise known as Julian Lutz. Julian's mother is a part of our church, and his family's been here for years. He's a Brampton guy, and he's become Director X. And so when he was here before Christmas, I was just asking him what he's up to these days. And I mean, he is all over the world speaking to young people. And one of the things that he's encouraging young people to do is to meditate, because he's recognized that meditation can change our thinking and our behavior and our life. And so he got me onto this book. I got to be honest to you, I don't understand half of this book, but this quote I do. He says, contemplative practices strengthen a specific neurological circuit that generates peacefulness, social awareness, and compassion for others. So when we spend time meditating, when we spend time in prayer, when we spend time reflecting on scripture, God literally is changing our neurons and the way we think and what's important to us. So that we literally become more like Jesus. His spirit enters into us and changes us, changes what we see, changes what's important, changes where our resources go, changes our love and the depth of our love for others and for this world. So the second part of our time together today, as far as the message is, how do we show God's love? Well, let's bring it back to Jesus, because we're trying to follow Jesus. That always seems like a good place to start. And Jesus's life was so wrapped up in this passage from 1 John. You probably caught it there, that God came in his son and gave of himself fully. And that's what this verse is about from John chapter 15, verses 12 and 13, these verses. It really comes in the time where Jesus has just had the Last Supper with his disciples. He is approaching the end of his life, and he gives them this encouragement as he does. My command is this, he says, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. That is worth meditating on, to think about a God who came and his life wasn't taken away. He gave it freely and fully out of love. What does that mean when we even begin to comprehend the magnitude of that? What does that mean for us as we try to live at least a little bit more like him? How do we show love?
Yeah. Looking to Jesus and that idea of giving that love, that laying down one's life, I think all of us have times like that where we, you know, the expression might be you go the extra mile, but where you do something for someone else that is more than either you imagined was possible of yourself as you gave yourself away, like that as you helped a person, as you did something that you didn't think you were capable of doing. This past fall, one of the things that we were doing was accompanying my mother-in-law, Joyce, through life and into death and life beyond death. We're still here, but she's moved into the next part. And it was an amazing gift. As much as it's a hard, hard time, there's also these grace-filled moments of accompanying a person who is, you know, whose life is narrowing down to, you can say to their last breath, but really it's to the fullness of love. And to discover in those hard, hard times, the complete grace that I think is God's love showing it. And so when I think about Jesus laying down his life for our friends, I mean, that's certainly not what we were doing, but what a great compassion it filled in us, which I think is God's love, to be able to accompany another person during that time in their life. I just think if we just keep looking to Jesus and the things that we were taught, we will find those ways of how to show love. I mean, one of the ones in James talks about learning to listen before we talk, you know, to not just to speak in anger. So often we have that reptilian want to get back at somebody. And just to take that breath. Okay, God, fill me up before I say something that I'm really going to regret like that. And so, you know, I think that's a great teaching. I think that's one of the ways that we show love, because really we don't have to say everything that's on our mind in that moment, do we? Good.
I just wish I would think about that, or God would put it in my mind before I do, but we'll keep working on that.
Yeah, keep thinking like that. And that suspending judgment. I mean, there's a passage that talks about, you know, instead of worrying about the speck in somebody else's eye, to take out the log in your own. And how often I have to remember that and live in it to it, you know, because I can be quick to judge, you know, make up a decision. And I was having a conversation with my sister-in-law last night, and she had been listening to Joyce Meyer, and she was saying, you know, she talked about that you actually had to choose to be nice. I'm like, uh-huh. and Karen works in a service industry, and she's realizing you have to choose to be nice. You know, Joyce Meyer said her husband is always nice. He never has to think about it, but she has to choose it. And I think that's also part of as we allow God to fill up all those places inside of us, as we begin to act out of that kind of same kind of love, then we can choose that kindness, we can choose compassion, we can choose to be nice, but we can choose to not judge so quickly, you know, and to just take that step back. Not judging quickly, just to say, that doesn't mean that something isn't wrong. That's not at all, and we're going to explore more of that next week with Ted. It doesn't mean that something's not wrong and that it was not to act, but it's sometimes we just put our own spin, values, sense of what's happening over on something. And our invitation from God is just, hey, don't worry about that one. Take the log out of your own eye first. Mm-hmm. It's one place.
Yeah, so we're trying to drill down this morning here and get concrete. What does it really mean for us to show love? And just to remind ourselves again that for many of us, I think probably for most of us, being human, we can't do these things on our own. That's why it's so important for the vehicle to be filled, for gas to be in the car, to have that receiving of the Holy Spirit so that we can do these things that we couldn't do on our own. And that is what allows us to live in this new way. I think of showing love in ways that Jesus did that can be a challenge. Sometimes it's loving people who are hard to love. We all have those people in our lives. Some of us live with them. I'm pointing to myself here. If you're around a couple years ago, I had this revelation that God gave me driving to the church one day that it was this. It was like, man, it must be hard to be married to me.
Amen.
For those who don't know, I'm pointing to my wife, Katrina, with great thanks and prayers. But it can be. We had a young adult who came through Alpha recently, who was back home after having been away. And if you've experienced that, you know, that can be really hard for everybody. And what happened for her was she discovered that Jesus wanted to give her his spirit day by day in a way that would give her patience that was beyond what she could do on her own. And it changed everything. Those are called the fruits of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5. Look them up. It's an amazing list. And that's what can happen when we receive, by the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus living in us that can live and love in a different way. What about tough conversations? As our worship team talked about this one, we said, don't forget that love is sometimes having difficult conversations, challenging conversations, tough conversations. I know for us as parents, there's a bunch of different stages that we go through where it's really hard. And we've had different times where, this doesn't come out of a parenting book, this is just our own experience, but where we've high-fived each other saying, you know what, sometimes our job as a parent is for our kids not to like us, and we've done that really well today. Because we had to say no, you know, or we had to set some boundaries. And I don't like feeling like a nag, but sometimes love is doing that, having those difficult conversations. Again, with the Holy Spirit in us, it'll be with gentleness and love, but it ain't easy. And that's showing love in a Jesus way. And when God gives us the courage to have those conversations, man, things change in a right and good way. And you feel better, actually. Because those conversations sit there for a long time, and we all have them. Maybe some of us have them right now. I'm thinking of a conversation that I know I need to have, and I've been afraid to have it. But love actually would say, have it with gentleness, with respect, with prayer, with humility, 100%. But have it. And watch what God will do. Showing love is something that we try to do as a church, as a community. This past week, we opened up our doors from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. with a drop-in for those on Let's Talk Day that were struggling with depression and anxiety. And just so grateful for that team. And I know I'm proud to be part of a church that's doing our very best to care for those, to bring healing and hope to those who struggle with mental wellness, mental health, because loving like Jesus means caring about these kinds of things. We have Good Friday outreach coming up. Friday, April the 10th. The mindset is this, the theology behind it is this. This is what we're talking about today, that God loved our world, each of us, in such a powerful way that God came and gave of himself, led to the cross. Jesus died for us out of incredible love. And on Good Friday, we celebrate that. It's powerful. And then we live into it, but we say, hey, let's go and serve our city and beyond to share this same love that Jesus has given to us. So we want to double. Like, we've had 100 people over the last year. We'd love to see 200 or more people going out to serve, to take that love of Jesus and to share it on Good Friday. That vision, that piece of work that God has led us to over the years has led to a bigger vision, where these days we're saying, what might we look like as a church 3 years from now? And there's a number of pieces to that. A revival, if you will. More people's hearts growing in love for Jesus and sharing that with others. How's that sound? Hey, that's right. That's where we're going. But part of that would be practically saying, what would it look like? Can you imagine this? What would it look like if we had outreach happening every single Sunday? Now, I know we can't all do that every Sunday. We've got lunches, and we've got sports, and we've got things. But imagine being part of a church where there were people who were coming to worship, being filled, growing our love for Jesus, and then going out after that to bring that love into this world. That's part of the vision that we see God has for our church. Unsung Hero Cards is another way that we've been having so much fun lately over the last few months to encourage those that are doing amazing things in our community.
Well, and I don't have the cards, but I think that they're at the information desk. Would that be right? And
so there's lots.
Yes. So I've taken some, but I didn't bring one up with me. And what a really cool way when you see somebody doing something that just goes the extra mile. So let me just give you an example. And I wish I'd had a card to be able to give her. My sister-in-law, who I was talking with last night, she was in a parking lot, and she didn't see that a man was trying to back into the parking space, and she drove into the one beside him, and so stopped him and everything else. Somebody else came along and yelled out their window at her, went he thought of her driving and her as a person. And then, yeah. and so she's smart enough not to respond, but she got out of the car and she just, you know, choose love, right? Hmm. And so she went to the man who now backed into car and she says, "I'm sorry, I never saw you." Like that, you know, and this man who, if I'd had a card, would love to have given him an unsung hero, he said, "Don't worry about it. And I'm sorry for that man who's just yelled at you." Like that, because that's not the way we want to be with one another. You know how quickly those parking lot things can escalate, right? Hmm. Can you just imagine just being able to say, "You know what? Like, you're an unsung hero," like this, and just thank you so much for that today. Yeah. How many other things? You know, the clerk who helps you in the grocery store, or the person at the gas station, you know, who's, you know, who pulls up when they see you behind because, you know, they've taken up two tanks. You know, like that, all of those kinds of things. Like, just what would it look like in our world if we started saying thank you, which I think is what the unsung hero cards can do. That it's one of the ways of showing love.
People wonder, we all do, what we do every day matters. And so this is a great way for us to encourage people to live into a life of new purpose, to share love. So grab some unsung hero cards, have them with you if you're into this. How many have given out a unsung hero card so far? Like, many people have. It's so much fun. There's crossing guards. We got a crossing guard neighbor. I got to stop and talk to her one day because she smiles and waves at everybody that drives by. I love it. I'm driving to work and I just feel better having passed her road. We have coaches who do amazing jobs working with young people, not just developing sports, but developing people. Give a coach an unsung hero card. Doctors, nurses, it's endless. And friends, this is one of the practical ways that we can share and show love. And we would love for everyone in Brampton and beyond to experience that love of Christ, that hope of Christ. And this is a very simple way that we can all participate in that. What we're talking about here today, it's beyond any one strategy, one idea, one ministry. Just want to name that. Like, what we're talking about, it's way beyond that. I think that's a good thing. Because God is way beyond our wildest dreams and imaginations. We can't wait to see what's going to happen over the course of this series. We're really going to hope you can join us throughout the month. I think what's happening, though, is Jesus is continuing to change who we are as we open up our lives to him. And that's why it's not just about one thing, one strategy. It's who we are and who we're becoming. Our world has had an interesting week around the loss of Kobe Bryant. And I recognize, like many do, that we have 41-year-olds who pass away every day. And so just want to name that. But this was tragic. This was, because it's so public, I think just more people had it on their minds and their hearts over this last week. And what happened, what I saw, observed, was this beautiful response of showing love that just became very natural. Where kids of all ages, people of all ages, we're talking about it, we're thinking about it, we're recognizing how precious our lives are. So hug the people who are in our lives just a little tighter and hold on and give thanks for them. Recognizing how special each day is, this gift of life that we've been given to make the most of what we have, that new purpose, that showing of love. All of that was kind of part of this natural response, if you will. I think what happens when Jesus enters more and more into us, we just live that way more naturally all the time. That's sort of what's happening here in this process of receiving and showing Jesus' love.
Yeah, and just one final comment. We're going to come to the table in just a couple of minutes. And communion, to me, is an act of love. I think when you think about that last gathering of Jesus with his friends, and we read the passage before where he said, "This is the commandment. This is the commandment. This is what I'm asking of you. Love one another as I love you." And so today, maybe you're not feeling that love at all inside. Maybe you're not sure if God could love you, whether it's God's job or not. Maybe you're just feeling like, hey, what I've done, there's nobody who can bridge that gap. Maybe you're feeling really alone today. And you're not sure if there's anyone who can really love you as you are. Maybe you're afraid of being vulnerable. because you've been hurt too often by being vulnerable and somebody's used that vulnerability against you. Today then is the day. No matter where you are in your relationship with God, is come to the table. Come and experience God's love fully for you. Come and taste and see that God is good. Come and see that this table is a way of God showing love for each and every single one of us. And as we receive and are filled up with that presence of God within us, we can then show love to one another in the fullness of Christ. So come to this table. Just invite you to take some time now. How are you receiving God's love? Maybe just breathe in. Breathe in and breathe out. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Be still and know that I am God. Come to the table and know me.
Friends, communion is such an act of incredible love that we want to continue to take some time to enter into it today. When you have a meal in your house, probably you take some time to clean the house. Anybody else? You know, you prepare. And so let's prepare for communion today, especially in light of what we've been talking about, because it is the ultimate act of love. One of the ways that we like to do that is to open up ourselves to receiving the Holy Spirit this morning. And sometimes we can create space for that by simply putting out our hands and having our hands open. I'm just going to invite us, if you're comfortable to do that. You don't have to. If you're only half open, put out one hand. If you're not, you can sit here like this. That's okay. But just putting out our hands sometimes reminds us that we're open to receiving this love of God that is so very real and can change everything. That changes us from the inside out. It actually changes how we think about ourselves, about others, about this world. And so our prayer this morning is, come, Holy Spirit, come. You are alive and in this place today, and you're calling out to us. You're pursuing us with abandon, with reckless love. And so we thank you for your faithfulness. Come, Holy Spirit. Continue to come and enter into each of us in this place. This table, this communion table, reminds us to do this in remembrance of you, remembrance of your faithfulness and your goodness. It doesn't mean that life has been easy, not at all. But it does mean that you have seen and continue to see us through. That you can bring healing to those deepest places within us. That you can give us energy and creativity and confidence and strength to be more than we could ever possibly be on our own. And so as we prepare for communion this morning, we say, come, Holy Spirit, come.